found that if there is a hung parliament in which the Liberals hold the balance and are in a position, because of numbers, to form a government with Labour, that an informal understanding already exists between you and the Labour leadership, which would make possible a commitment to PR and would make possible a coalition. Then is there any truth in that?
Then let me unequivocally put that rumour, Robin, to rest. If you hear that, you hear wrong.
In view of the crucial influence, Mr. Ashdown, you could have in the new parliament, there are some questions which should be asked about your past judgments. For instance, do you regret that you spoke at a campaign for nuclear disarmament rally with Neil Kinnock in 1983?
No, I've never been a member of CND, and I've spoken on all platforms. I've spoken on extreme right-wing conservative platforms. I happen to believe that on all platforms, and in a country that runs on freedom of speech, you're entitled to stand up in any audience and in any platform and put your point of view, which is what I did.
Do you regret that in 1984 you advocated removal of cruise missiles forthwith?
No, I believe that to have been the right judgment at the time, but those circumstances changed almost months later, as I predicted they would. I've always wanted to pursue disarmament by the most practical and safest means possible, and I've said at the time when I made that speech that if the talks restart, which they did in 2 or 3 months later, then the best way to achieve that disarmament would be through the talks, not through that kind of action.
But you think you don't regret your opinion, you think your judgment was right?
Robin, I've made many mistakes, and I've been prepared to... No, I'm prepared to admit them. If that was a mistake, I'd admit it, but I don't believe it was.
Which mistakes would you admit of significance in the public field?
Do you really want me to drag these out here?
I'm policy.
Yes, I'm quite happy to mention perhaps a couple. I think I may have tried to move the party on policy rather too fast when I became its leader than was sensible. But you learn your mistakes and you learn from them, and you're a fool if you believe that you're infallible and that you can't learn from your mistakes.
Would not the sort of proportional representation you demand be grossly undemocratic for this reason? That no one would get the government they voted for, and no one would get the policies they voted for, because the parties would have to form coalitions and compromise their policies. Well, what would be democratic about that?
It's a jolly good try, Robin, but if that's the case...
No, it's a serious argument.
Well, it's not really a serious argument. I mean, it's the kind of argument that's made by those people who want to tie this country into the constitutional dark ages for the benefit of the Conservative and Labour Party. I mean, the fact of it is, do you then say that Germany is a non-democratic country? It's got considerable more democracy...
They don't have the single transferable vote.
No, but they have a system of proportional representation, which in terms of government amounts to the same thing. The fact of it is that politicians are about achieving compromises in order to get things through when you can assemble a majority of the voters of the country behind you. That's what democracy is about. This is not a democracy in those terms. We allow a government to inflict the poll tax, something which nearly 60% of the people at the last election voted against, to inflict that upon us on the basis of achieving 37% of the available votes. That's not a democracy. What you have to do in a democracy is to assemble a majority of the people for the proposition you put forward. Proportional representation does that. Our present system manifestly does not.
Your manifesto says that electoral reform is, and I quote, the key to a successful future.
Correct.
Many people reading that may say to themselves, how so? What on earth is the relevance of PR to better schools, curbing inflation, unemployment, homelessness, or any of our other problems?
Let me take that absolutely face too. Better schools. Would we not have better schools if we'd not had this ridiculous dogmatic argument by Labour and Tories on the basis of less than 50% of the vote, the one helping private schools, the other helping but underfunding public schools? This has been, education has been, as health service has become, as the steel industry was, a shuttlecock that's been bashed backwards and forwards by two political sets of extremists at the damage of the country. If you want to see a way to do this, you want to see a way to construct a system that provides a more successful economy, and if I may say so, a more successful society as well. Take a look at some of those countries, Germany for example, where there is an electoral, where there's proper system of electoral representation, and where you have changes of an incremental rather than extremist sort, through which economists, industrialists can invest for the long term.
Seems to me you're not proving that PR will correct these problems. You're proving or suggesting that if you have an electoral system which produces more liberals in a better position of influence, you will get liberal policies.
It's nothing to do with liberals. It's to do with assembling governments that have more than 50% of the support of the people behind them. And that's a stable government, and Germany has benefited from that, and Britain has not.
And you're saying of necessity, if we had PR, liberals would be in a stronger position?
No, you're saying that.
And in a permanent position.
You're saying that. I'm saying that PR is one of those mechanisms of constitutional change that must now be adopted in Britain. We have to modernise our democracy. This is the most outdated, secretive, centralised democracy in Europe, and that is not unconnected with our failure of government
but
over the last 40 years.
But they have first past the post in the United States. Isn't that modern?
Well, there's a wholly different system. They don't have a multi-party system as we do here. And indeed, they have parties who don't differ on ideology and policy so much. But in the European systems, a modernized democracy, which includes, incidentally, the devolution of power, it includes a Bill of Rights, it includes a Freedom of Information Act, and it includes fair voting. A modernized democracy is the prerequisite, the foundation stone, for sensible, stable, effective government. We have none of those things in Britain, and the result is we have unsensitive, instable, and as we have seen from the last 13 years, thoroughly ineffective government.
Picking you up on devolution there, why don't the Liberal Party, why don't you and the Liberal Party support independence for Scotland within Europe instead of the halfway house of devolution that Labour has, home rule? Why aren't you more radical
than
Labour?
Labour has followed the policy that we've had for 100 years, if I put you right on your history,
yes, Robin.
It's Labour that's come on board to this, not us, because we believe it to be wrong, because we believe a devolved structure of government for this country in which you have a federal structure, Scotland having its own parliament, rather like the Länder in Germany and elsewhere.
You keep referring to Germany.
Well, choose another one then. Choose the United States.
Every answer you said, we want to do it like Germany.
Well, fair enough, Robin. You raise the United States. Choose the United States if you wish.
Only once.
But let me put it to you this way, that a modern structure for government does devolve power. And there is no earthly reason why Scotland should cast adrift from Great Britain. And Mr. Major's claim that devolution is a halfway house to independence is absolute nonsense. You name me a single case anywhere in the world or anywhere in history where providing for devolution has led to independence. Quite the contrary, resisting devolution has led to independence. And believe me, Robin, I speak with some personal knowledge of this. I'm an Irishman. 70 years ago, my country was caught, as indeed it's caught today, between extremist unionists and extremist separatists. And I know what can happen to a country under those circumstances.
You want a federal Europe, and you want, you've just said, and you want a federal United Kingdom with home rule, with separate parliaments for Scotland, Wales, and who knows, for Yorkshire, Cornwall, and so on. Aren't you going to have enough government for everybody there? And rather too much for many people?
Well, you've got too much government at present in Westminster. What we want to do is break that up and spread it.
But have six or seven parliaments in this tiny island?
Well, just a moment, why not?
Well, why?
Well, because that puts government effectively closer to the people. One of the problems in this country is that Whitehall has gathered all the power to itself and makes ridiculous decisions and inappropriate decisions about the management of local economies. Let me give you an example. This country is run for the benefit of the economy of the South East. The South East's position in the economic cycle is not necessarily the same as we see now as the point on the economic cycle of the North or of Scotland. So why is it appropriate to inflict upon the North of England the policies which happen to suit the economy of the South East? It would be much better if we had power spread in this country. That doesn't mean more government, because it means breaking up the government that's currently at Whitehall and making sure it's put closer to the people. That makes government more accountable. It makes it more open, and it makes it more sensible.
Why are you so keen to see Europe develop into a federal European super state?
I don't believe that it would be a super state, not in the sense that you refer it. I want to see a Europe in which a proportion of the power, the sovereignty, lies at the European level, but is properly accountable to the European citizens.
But if you believe in a single European currency, as you do, and a central European bank, as you do, does not a central European bank automatically mean a single European government?
Yes. There's an element of government at the European level, yes.
But who will it be accountable to?
Who is our present government accountable to, Robin? It's accountable to
the people in this election.
The people who elect it. And that's why we want to see power with European MEPs to hold that to account.
Nobody's going to elect a federal European government.
Well, what they're going to do is elect MEPs who carry the democratic accountability to the European level. I mean, it is simply ludicrous of this government to claim that the bureaucrats in Brussels are out of control, and there are some cases where that happens, and so are the Council of Ministers with one breath, and then say they're not prepared to have our elected representatives at the Brussels level allow them to have more power to hold those bureaucrats to account at the other. Those are two mutually contradictory statements.
If
we say that if you have some of the people's sovereignty vested at the European level, and why not, then that sovereignty and the power that lies there must be accountable to the citizen. And the only way you do that is through the democratic process and through giving MEPs more power.
If Mr. Neil Kinnock does become Prime Minister, of a minority government or not, or a majority government, then your hope of replacing Labour as the radical alternative to Toryism goes down the drain, doesn't it?
No.
Why not?
Because I don't believe that Mr. Kinnock and the Labour Party, with unfettered power to govern this country, would be anything other than a disaster, and I would apply the same to the Tory party as well. The job of my party is to state its positions, to state them clearly, as you see in the manifesto, to have the courage to say the things that are necessary and we believe to be right, and to leave the judgment then in the hands of the British people, and I'm prepared to do that in the short term and in the long. I am confident about this fact, that the Liberal Democrats now stand astride the agenda that will matter in the 1990s, on the environment, on the free market economy, on the business of constitutional change, on taking our opportunities in Europe, and the other parties will have to come to us on these matters. We will be the vanguard of British politics in the 1990s. That's the way it's developing, and that's the way I'm determined it should remain.
And finally, Mr. Ashdown, will not the Liberal Party be squeezed out by the can't-win feeling?
No sign of it at present, is there? The other two parties are stuck. And you know, in politics, where you are matters less than where you're going. They're both stuck. There's only one party that's rising at present, and that's the Liberal Democrats, both in the polls and in the ballot box. That's the way it'll continue during this election.